All right, ladies and gentlemen, we're going to talk about relays today. Try to polish up a couple things on the ever popular 9340 relay. That is 90340. So 9340 relay. And this is what we got right here in front of us. You can see here, this is a White Rogers relay. It says type 91. But right here it says 9340, and that's what this particular relay is. It's a very common relay for things such as your indoor fan motor. And you can see here there's some other pertinent details on the data plate as well. There's one on the front and also on the back. So just as a refresher, what information do we need to know about a relay in order to replace one that you've diagnosed as bad? Okay. Anytime you do a replacement, there's things that you need to know about the component in order to match it properly. The first thing you're going to need to know is the coil voltage. We typically use 24-volt coils in our field to control the switches and things that run our system. So we need to know the coil voltage. The second thing we need to know is the number and type of switches we're using. Are we using one normally open switch and one normally closed? Are we using two normally opens, two normally closed? There's a plethora of different options out there. So you need to know what type of switches you need and how many of that type. Okay. Last but not least, once you know the information about your switches, you need to know how many amps they can handle. So switch ampacity, how many amps are going to be going through the normally open or normally closed switches that you do need. Okay, so it's very much like a contactor, simple information that you need to know: coil voltage, number and type of switches, and then the ampacity of those switches. So I'm not going to focus too much, but I am going to show you the data plate that we have. You've already taken a look at it once. This is our White Rogers brand, a 90340 relay, and you can see here on the front it tells you that the coil is 24 volts. So this will work with most of our residential style heating and air equipment. If I were to flip this unit over, you can see the backside. This is going to give us our ampacity and voltage rating on these switches. So you can see across the top here, I've got 12 FLA, full load amps, 60 lock rotor amps, LRA, at 125 volts. So if I run 125 volts through here, I can handle, in the case of a fan motors are an induction load. They are not like electric heat, that is a resistive load. The fan motors are going to pull a higher amperage on startup and basically die down or slow down to a cruising speed, you know, their normal rotation. So as we look here, you can see that on the startup amps, I can handle up to 60 of the lock rotor, that initial inrush current, high amp draw load. And then once the motor starts going, then as the motor dies down to its running amperage, I can have no more than 12 full load amps on this. Most of the time our blower is only going to run 4 or 5 amps or so, depending on different factors for that particular motor. But this 12 full load amps can definitely handle most of our indoor motor needs that we're going to run across. So we're full load amps, your lock rotor amps, and then your voltage. You can see here, if I ran up to a 277 volt through this switch, then I could have 6 full load amps and 35 lock rotor amps. Okay, so high inrush current, the lock rotor amps at 35, and then I can get the 6 full load amps, your running amps basically. We can go more into depth later on that. If I was going to run something, a resistive load through here, not necessarily an electric heater, but something of the sort, maybe a small, I don't know, if this is a refrigerator, maybe you have a little heater in the door frame to keep any moisture buildup around the seal or what. This is a 15 amp resistive load. Your resistive load is a steady load. It doesn't have the inrush current and then the running amperage that you would normally have with an induction load. So basic information there, not trying to rehash this. I want to go over more detail about the switches. So you can see here, and I'll try to get the light just right. You can see here on the top that we've got several switches going on. I've got terminal one right here, as indicated on the right there by the little shadow underneath my little pointer. Terminal one is right here. Terminal two is here on this middle terminal, a little bit lower, and then terminal three here. This is one set of switches. Now, the way that they have laid out this little diagram on top of the relay, you can see that these switches are connected. So I've got three terminals and two switches on or between those terminals, okay? From one to three is a normally open. And you can see right there is that normally open indication, that little schematic view. And then from one to two is normally closed. So one to two is normally closed. One to three is normally open. And these are one set of switches. They act when the 24-volt coil is energized, you know, of course, from the thermostat. So in the case of an indoor fan relay, when the thermostat sends 24 volts down the green wire, it's going to go ultimately here to this coil. How does it do that? Well, if you look right here, it's so simple, right? These terminals right here on the end, they are not labeled like your switches are, but down here at the bottom, we've got a set of double stake-ons right here, and then over here, we've got another set. This is going to be your G going in, your 24 volts coming in on one side. Doesn't have to be the right side as I'm holding it here. It could be on the left side. But whatever side the G comes in, the opposite side is going to be where your common hooks up and returns back to power at the transformer. Okay? The relay coil is easily identified by the copper wire that is coming off the bottom of these male stake-ons and wraps around and goes to the bottom of the coil. So you can see right here, there's a little copper wire that is soldered into this male stake-on connection here. And the same thing over here. Try to get a little bit closer. There we go. You can see that copper wire as it's in there on both sides. So that's our coil. On the top of this 9340 relay, they label the switches. And I've already gone through terminals 1, 2, and 3. But there is a identical kind of sister set of switches that's 4, 5, and 6. Okay? It is the same layout as the first set of switches we went over, and it acts at the same time, but it's a completely separate circuit. So I could run two different loads through here, different voltages if need be, but they are completely separate. I'll try to throw up a little picture or a little schematic, but it's fairly easy to understand. 1, 2, and 3 is one set of switches, and 4, 5, and 6 is another set of switches. Most people don't have confusion with that. I know personally when I first started learning about relays years ago when I got into the field, I didn't have a eureka moment until I realized one big thing about this relay. Most people, and I'm going to say here in the Western world, okay, we read left to right, and for whatever reason, we get in our mind that power has to flow through here from left to right. And I think once you know the three basic things that you need to replace this component, the coil voltage, ampacity of the switches, and the number and type of switches that you have on that relay, the second thing you really have to get in your head is understanding, you have to understand circuits more so than the relay. This relay is just a switch, either normally open or normally closed. Of course, when the coil gets voltage, 24 volts, it's going to make those switches do the opposite. Okay, you get all the bells, the whistles, the clicks, the pops, but a lot of people, they get caught in their head, they get tunnel vision that power has to come in here on terminal one and out on number three, because that's the way you see it and that's the way you read. You read left to right, top to bottom. But that's not the case with relays. Once you get into the field and you really understand, you can see or you'll learn that not only can I come in and flow through here, bring power in on terminal one and out on terminal three, I can actually do it backwards. I can do it in on terminal three and out on terminal one. So that's a big deal. I'm not trying to push that. I'm just trying to give you something to think about with this. But for me, when I wrote down in my little clipboard as a young heat and air tech, the first thing that I had to write down and go home and study and really commit to learning was this relay. And I think a lot of people are thrown off by it, and it's just the way it is until you learn. But you have to put in your time and effort and try to understand electricity and circuits and diagrams and get into it. Okay, so I hope you get into it, but just think about this. Not only does power or can power flow in terminal one, out terminal three, the left to right as we're talking about, I can actually bring it in terminal three and out terminal one. Truth be told, a lot of times when we're dealing with a heat strip system that is interlocked with the blower circuit, we're actually bringing power in terminal three and out terminal one to go to a certain fan speed on a PSC motor. So make sure that you think about that. It's not left to right. It can be right to left. But no matter what, no matter how this is working, or if you're only using one set of switches instead of both set of switches, I've got two sets of switches. They are identical in their makeup, normally open, normally closed, and they both react. Since I've got two sets of switches on this relay, both act at the same time, instantaneous, with that 124 volt signal that we have. So keep that in mind. The last thing that I'm going to really go in and show you is voltage checks. So I'm going to go out here on a practice board. I've got a 9340 relay wired up. I'm going to do some voltage checks across this switch because not only in the schematic reading and learning switches and the whole left to right that we mentioned, voltage checks across the switch throw a lot of technicians. So I'm going to go wire up a little practice board, take you along, and hopefully this will make some sense to you. All right, here we go. I've got a practice board we use here at school. And what I've done is I've wired up real simple, 24 volts to the fan relay coil. And we're gonna use this 9340 as a fan relay. But I've wired up the 24 volts coming from our thermostat. And to replicate a motor, we've got a 120 volt light, okay? So real simple, when I turn on the fan from the auto to the on position on the thermostat, the light comes on. When I turn it back to auto, the light goes off. So we're sending 24 volts to the coil. When the coil gets power, it's going to close our connection, our switch from terminal 1 to 3, and it's going to open from terminals 1 to 2. If I were to add in another wire on the 1 to 2 terminal, then I could easily control a second light. As you read this set of switches from left to right, terminal 1 is bringing power in and terminal 3 is power out. Terminal 2 would also be power out because we're looking at it as we read from left to right. So you can see here that going through the normally closed from terminal 1 out terminal 2, I've got a normally closed switch and that brings on a light. When I energize my 24 volt coil by calling for the fan, now you can see that the lights shift. My normally closed from 1 to 2 is now open and shut the light off, and the switch from terminals 1 to 3 is closed, so I turn on this second light. Once I take power away from G, everything goes back and forth. So as we read the relay from left to right, I can take one power source in on terminal 1 and control two different loads depending on whether or not I'm using the normally open or normally closed switch. But this isn't typical of what we do for our residential heating and air. Typically, we use it backwards. We have two power sources coming in on terminal 3 and another on terminal 2, and it is going out on terminal 1 towards our fan motor, to our PSC motor for a high, medium, or low speed. So I'm only going to run through this one example here because I mainly want to talk about the voltage. So here we go. I've got my voltmeter set up right here. I'm going to turn the light on. I think that'll come into play. So right now I have got no power, 0 volts on my 24 volt coil. And because of that, I am flowing electricity through the normally closed switch. So it's real simple. If I were to check voltage across that switch right now, 1 to 2, I am getting, better yet, here we go, from terminal 1 to 2, I get 0 volts and my light is on. A lot of technicians, I feel, don't understand why.
It is because power coming in on terminal one is coming from your L1, we'll say, and it is immediately flowing out terminal two. So I've got L1 coming in and L1 coming out. What is the difference between L1 and L1? It is zero. Okay, that switch is closed. If I were to do the same check from one to three right now, I'm going to come over here and do terminal one to terminal three. You can see that I've got 122 volts, but that light is off. It's because that switch is open. Voltage checks across the switch, if you know the full voltage of your power source, in this case 120 volts, if you check across a switch and it's closed, you will get 0 volts and your light will be on. That's because you're passing L1 power into the switch and also out of the switch. And L1 versus L1, which is what our voltmeter does, it doesn't tell us if the power's on or off. It tells us the potential difference between the two places that we reference with our leads. So the difference in 120 volts and 120 volts is nothing. It's a simple math problem. Okay? So voltage here, 0 volts on the switch, light is on. 122 volts across the normally open switch, which is terminal 1 to 3, I've got 121 and a half volts over here. And my light is off. A technician in the field that doesn't understand switches is going to say, I've got power on these two terminals. Why isn't my light on? And the answer is simple. It's because your switch is open. As soon as I apply 24 volts, things change. So down here at the bottom on my 24-volt coil, I've got 26.8 volts. So my coil is now energized. You can hear it click as the switches move. My voltage on terminals 1 and 3, which go to this light bulb here that's on, is going to be 0. Why? Because L1 power is coming in and L1 power is going out. When I reference L1 to L1, there is no difference between them. It's 120 volts going in and 120 volts going out. So there is no difference in that potential. So light bulb on, that definitely means that the switch is closed. When technicians think deeper than that and they wonder about the voltage across the switch, that's when we oftentimes get confused. I don't know how many motors I've seen replaced because a technician measured voltage across a switch and the motor wasn't on. It's not the motor, it's the switch. So I hope this helps a little bit. I'm gonna leave this lead in real quick and run through a couple dry runs here. So 26 volts, this normally open switch is now closed because the coil is energized and the light turns on. As soon as I take that away, I drop down to just a couple volts on this coil, so that it is not energized, and now the connection from 1 to 2 is back normally closed, and I'm passing power to the other light bulb. So voltage across a switch, if you get 0 volts, there's two possibilities. One, the power's not on. Two, the switch is closed. If the switch is closed, I will power that load. When I apply power to the coil, all the switches move. Normally open becomes closed, and normally closed becomes open. And I break this circuit, in this case, from the 1 to 2 terminal, and I stop sending power. That voltage across that switch is going to be 120 volts. Why is that? It's because the switch is open now. And because the switch is open, the light bulb is not shining. So I hope this makes a little bit of sense. There is, of course, a lot more that we could go in depth with, but I'm trying to give you something to look at and also think about as you try to learn how things in this field work. So voltage gets a lot of people, especially across a switch. So let me know how it goes, and we'll try to explain it more if we need to.